1986, Ambiance, in their first international competition, won their crowns as international champions. They did not let that be their ultimate goal. Since that time, they've continued to grow and expand and become one of the most phenomenal quartets Food Headlines has ever seen. I'd like to read you a quote out of a magazine called the Contemporary Acapella Newsletter. The editor-in-chief and publisher devoted a one-page space to comments about barbershoppers and Food Headlines International. He says, barbershop groups are, quote, responsible for some of the most beautiful, precise music in America. The managing editor reviewed Ambiance's new release, Jazz Ladies, and he comments, quote, Ambiance's bright and energetic sound is still fresh and like no other group in the world. Ambiance is one of the finest groups singing in this country today. Their musicianship, blend, and arrangements are a model for all aspiring professionals. That says it all. Ladies and gentlemen, Ambiance.
If I do the church on Sunday and cattle down. great time today. It's been wonderful. The weather is nice and brisk and cool, and we just went out to the wildlife park outside of Peoria to have a... I was actually looking for wildlife, but there were just animals out there. And we had lunch, and boy, did we have lunch. Some of us had more lunch than the costume can stand. Anyway, we are Ambiance, and we are definitely a Midwest representation. When we go out to sing all over the world, we tell them all that we're from the Midwest. Two of us are from St. Louis, Missouri. One of us, thank you, St. Louis. Both of them are here, and the other four folks are here. And one of us is from Chicago. Friends from Chicago. Both of our friends. And then, of course, I'm from Illinois. They all know, though. They do. They know that Chicago is part of Illinois. Not as far as all of us here are concerned. Back in Fats Waller's time, when he was a young man toward the end of his career, actually about when he's 38, 39 years old, he was working a movie on the West Coast called Stormy Weather, and he was missing the East Coast. He was, thank you very much. That sounds like the kids at home. The Walls will be coming in next. And anyway, he wanted to go back to Harlem. He wanted to be back home, and he missed it very much. And so in his memory, he was recalling his days in Harlem as a youth and as a performer. And years ago in New York City, the blacks were not allowed to come in the front door of any establishment. They're much less entertainers. And he thought it would just be so wonderful to be able to walk in the front door of Carnegie Hall, which he eventually was able to do and perform in Carnegie Hall. Plus, he also wanted, his big dream was to be able to entertain in the ballroom of the Waldorf Astoria and be treated like he really was somebody. We'd like to take you back and recreate that time for you. It's called Lounging at the Waldorf.
Yeah.
Baptist preacher, and his mama played the piano and the old pump organ, and that's where Fats first learned to play. Nasty coughing, and honey, you're going to be better soon. It's okay, Mom, let him cough. You little darling. I've survived five of those little darlings, as a matter of fact. In fact, my baby is 260 pounds and about 6'11". He's the biggest kid I've ever seen in my life, you know, and he's really been the joy of my life. Yeah. You believe that? If there's any way to put that sucker back, he'd be gone. Bibles in Harlem, and he grew up on gospel music. And when he was 16 years old, his mama died, and he lost his very best friend. And this was one of her very favorite songs.
Steal away. Thank you.
think we'll do something else. It's a religious experience. We'll pass the hat. Well, let's see here. Tell you what, we've done gospel and we've done... I tell you what, let's do a show tune. Would you like to do a show tune, Sandy?
Yeah.
Okay, why don't we do your solo? Would you like that?
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Finally. Okay, well, we're going to do a show tune, and it's from West Side Story, and it features our baritone, Sandi Wright, and it's called Something's Coming. Yes. You ready?
Uh-huh.
What's the matter?
Well, I'm just not in the mood yet.
That sounds like a line I've used. Not recently, however. Oh, my goodness. So you taking on this, Jackie?
I should hold this for you. I'm hoping so.
I gave this to both of the kids.
I'm supposed to be able to sing and be professional and hold your clothes.
Barbershoppers and the tenor singers. It's kind of interesting that you would have a tenor having a communications degree. Because the elevator most of the time does not go all the way up. It's kind of one of those oxymoron kind of things, you know, like government worker, postal service, jumbo shrimp, yeah, all those kind of things. And so we've just been really, really proud of her. She made straight A's all through school. She couldn't write the rest of the alphabet for the darn thing. And to our left here, this is Sandi Wright. To our left is Sandi Wright. Never works. And Sandi is also in PR in the public relations field. And right now, Sandi is, one of her clients is a lubricant place called Phillips 66. Sandy's dealing in oil. I always wanted to marry somebody in oil, but I didn't know. She just works in oil. And so she's actually in the sales staff. And Sandy's also a resident gourmet chef. She invented blackened cooking before it was popular. She has three settings on her stove, high, low, and flush.
There's no time to eat because the fire alarm goes off.
And this is Diane Huber, and Diane sings bass, and she's from the St. Louis area. She has a fantastic family home, three good-looking boys, and a wonderful husband. Actually, all the discipline in her house falls to her, but she kind of likes that. Her heroine in Catholic girls' school was Sister Mary Charles Bronson. And my name is Elizabeth Hardcastle, and I sing lead, and I'm from a little farming community outside of Decatur, Illinois, by the name of Oakley.
Yeah,
I have a pretty interesting life.
Yeah,
what do you want to do for a living?
I don't want to tell them.
I think you should tell them. Don't you want to know what she does? I work in a nuclear power plant.
Yes, she does.
And I do not glow in the dark. No, unless you like it that way. In fact, two of my coworkers are working. They're here today, as a matter of fact.
That glow you see.
It's the glow up there in the back hall, right there. I just sit there in the back.
You're
so glad that they drove all that way to see us. I just found this bundle of love letters. They were stuffed way, way back in the drawer. And I had wrapped them in a pretty peach ribbon. And I thought when I had tied these letters up that I had put you away in a safe, safe place. I know that I should just tear these things up and go on to bed. each time I read the words that you wrote and I run my fingers across the pages, I can still hear your laughter. I can still feel your touch. And each time, the ending's the same. Pretty all much dress alike. Yeah. It seems to be a thing that we do. You know, it's all the chorus, everybody had my. And so we have really tried in this quartet to conform, and all of us have tried to dress like. For 6 years, we have not been able to agree on one thing, anything. What car to get into, what door to open, anything. So putting on a costume alike is just pretty with not that's what he thinks, right? You kids over here going, that's yeah, right, that's great. Just as long as they don't throw fruit. Yeah. And start throwing vegetables. And so what we've had a little problem here with getting a costume to evolve here. So this year's costume, we all say, well, we've had black and white and red somehow. And so for 6 months it's been evolving, and every time we come out on stage, somebody has something new on that's black, white, or red. So it's kind of a moving target. And it's been kind of interesting all the way along. By the way, where is the rest of your dress?
It's right here.
Looks like your cummerbund slipped. Anyway, and then of course over here on the other side of me, you know, this one should be talking. She went out and slaughtered a Holstein. And you're like, well, this is very, very,
call me an old heifer for you.
So anyway, that's how the costume has evolved. We want to thank you all for being such a super audience. A lot of times our families travel with us, and we have Shelly's husband Vern and her son Alex with us this afternoon, and we also have my son Bill and his wife who live here in Peoria, as a matter of fact. But their last name's different than mine, so they won't be harassed. They're really nice people. They live out in Freeport, and they're really neat. My oldest son. Let's see. We would like to do a tune for you for our very last number. It's and by the way, our road manager, Robbie Pierce, is also with us. She's the girl back at the table, so you get a chance to say hello to her. She's from Wichita, Kansas.
Yeah.
So we're from everywhere. And I would like very much to thank you all for coming out this afternoon. For our final number, we'd like to do a tune that was written by George Gershwin. And from our arranger, he put his recollections, his insight, and his heartfelt feelings that he experienced when he went to New York City as a young grad student. And it's called Rhapsody in Blue, and it's written by David Wright.
Oh.
Hardcastle Station Wall, city with Mixing and tuning into a melody with rhythm and harmony too, and suddenly there.